Michał Karnowski. Welcome.
Good morning. Good evening. Yeah. It's a great honor to be here. Let me start from something which I remember from my childhood. Some 40 years ago, Ronald Reagan told a joke about an American who tells a Russian that the United States is so free that he can go to the White House, enters the president's office, bang his fist and shout, "To hell with Ronald Reagan." And the Russian replies, "That is nothing special. I can go to Mr. Gorbachev's office, bang my fist on the table and say, 'To hell with Ronald Reagan too.'" And I think we found ourselves in similar situations. Freedom of speech and the right to political action is only for a selected few, only for those who agree with those in power. If you have doubts, even doubts, you become a populist, a nationalist, a monster. And they start immediately persecuting you, ridiculing you. So there is a question. Will nations with thousands of years and more of history of statehood continue to accept such humiliation? The answer will come soon, maybe after the European election. Dear guests, 2 days of interesting debates, full of passion, love of Europe, and full of valuable knowledge, for which I would like to thank the organizers and participants, have given us a clear conclusion. We have lost many battles, but this one, battles of treaties, cannot be lost. Our sovereignty and freedom are at stake. If we fail here, things like the nightmare Green Deal, which is destroying European competitiveness, and so-called migration pact, which is the open oppression of societies, which invites dozens of millions more migrants into Europe, will be received at every command of the so-called liberal and leftist masters of the European Union. And while it is rightly stressed many times in this meeting that the EU has been stolen from the peoples of Europe by extremists, that we should not confuse European Union with Europe, the reality is brutal. Another decisive battle lies ahead. Will we manage to stop new EU treaties, which bring hundreds of changes, the most important of which are the abolition of the veto and the handing over to the Brussels-based, de facto not controlled by the voters, European Commission, powerful tools, new competences, all at the expense of the nation states, reduced here to the role of local government units, of less importance than German lands. The EU Parliament has approved a proposal for EU treaty reform in November 2023 with slight majority, triggering the formal request to the heads of the state to vote on whether to open the EU reform convention. Is this slight, are this slight majority and new election ahead of us a source of hope? On the one hand, certain. Who knows, maybe we are closer to blocking this than we think, maybe the present majority is on thin ice. On the other hand, the machine moves on. The inexorable steamroller destroys any resistance. In Poland, we are being blackmailed. If you want enlargement of the Union, including the Western Balkans or Ukraine, which is of course not decided, you must agree to these treaties. They claim that without new rules, such a large union will not be able to function. Is it really a truth? So what are our chances? What are our chances? What is most important here? How do we defend? How do we can defend ourselves? So I hereby open the panel debate entitled Revision of the Treaties, a Swan Song of the European Project. I warmly welcome the participants. I'd like to invite to the stage my guests, and they are Mr. Martin Duris from Slovakia. Mr. Martin is, who is advisor on foreign policy, geopolitical analysis, analyst international relations team leader of the Republika Party. And it is worth emphasizing, he published and invited to media and conference on 5 continents and in more than 40 countries. The second guest, Mr. Nuno Martins, is the director for EU affairs of the European Jewish Congress, former political advisor in the European Parliament, focused on Middle East affairs, born in Lisbon. Kosmas Wojtowski from Poland, MEP, Law and Justice Party, ECR Group, and as well candidate for the next term in European Parliament. So if you are living in Poland, you maybe have the chance to vote for him, because in Poland we have lists, not one list in the European Parliament. But Mr. Juan Soto from Spain, social entrepreneur, founder of several think tanks, founder of Fairchess Consulting Company. Yeah. Rob Ross from Netherlands, MEP, vice chairman of the European Conservatives and Reformist Group. And General Mircea Telian from Romania. MP, former chief of the Romanian army and deputy leader of the AUR parliamentary group in the Chamber of Deputies. Yes. There was an idea of creating a discussion, but probably no microphones. Yeah? So, who first, maybe?
So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for having me. Thank you to organizers from our party, our dear friends, Multiplens Rumos, and thank you all precious guests, friends, patriots from all Europe, all countries, and the United States. Just one thing, I think Europe needs much more patriots in the European Parliament, and our American friends deserve a president who shakes the hand with real people, not invisible ones. The topic is revision of treaties. If I would have just 10 seconds to express my viewpoint, I would say the revision of treaties in form proposed in AFCO Committee of European Parliament is a bad idea, period. But okay, the question is why? Someone can say, because in November 23, it was proposal no one other but Mr. Verhofstadt. And everyone knows, it was really proposal of this guy, and everyone knows the European Parliament atmosphere, knows who it is. I just remember still in times of Nigel Farage, when he was in plenary, one time he said, if this place would be temple, he stood in European Parliament, Mr. Verhofstadt would be its high priest. Yes, Mr. Verhofstadt is really embodiment of everything what you do not want. What more, we should be very watchful when people like this man or members of Renew Greens or von der Leyen-like representatives tell us allegedly they seek to enhance the EU's capacity to act and strengthen citizens' voice. Strengthen citizens' voice. We all remember the Treaty of Lisbon and the case of Ireland. We have to repeat the referendum to get correct result. Or look on conference about future of Europe, which is organized every year in European Parliament. And what we see just expensive charades of favoring pro-Brussels NGOs, pro-Brussels activists, Green Deal radicals, and their leaflets. So, when we say about planned revision of treaties planned by people who does not care, who does not love people and freedoms of citizens of European member states, there is a long list of risks, maybe so long, like from Brussels to this beautiful building. And just to mention some of them, removing the veto power in all areas, qualified majority voting in foreign security and defense policy, changes in the single market and the economy, which goes to the basis and to the roots of the European Union, exclusive EU's competence in climate politics, more EU competences in education, migration, and so on. So to summarize, these changes, exactly like the title of discussion says, these changes can be a really swan song for a European project, can create significant tensions inside the European Union, and London may not be last one who will leave EU's ranks. And maybe we can discuss about revision of treaties, not only according to Brussels' hunger for more power, but we should discuss too about powers, what we can take back. That's the reason why European election will be so important. Thank you very much. Mulțumesc mult.
Good afternoon. I want to thank our party for the invitation and for the amazing conference that you have organized. It is interesting to have this combination of what are the new treaties and the respective peculiarity of each member state of the European Union. I think one of the challenges we face today, if we go back to the history of the European Union, is that instead of taking advantage of each member state's particularities, positive things, the European Union is trying to create a European federalism where there is no more member states but just a concentration of powers in Brussels. Which means that a country like Poland, which is a country of passage, which is a country surrounded by other countries in the European Union, which is different from my home country, Portugal, which is a country in the periphery of the European Union, but at the same time is a country with an Atlantic vocation that can lead and link Europe with the Atlantic Ocean and other continents, are losing these particularities. And this creates, in my view, two things. First, this was not the idea of the founding fathers of the European Union, because the founding fathers of the European Union, as border men like Robert Schuman from Alsace, they were worried and they were basically focusing on creating a peaceful Europe. But peaceful Europe doesn't mean not be prepared for war. They were focusing on peace among member states within the European Union, first and foremost. And what we have today is exactly the opposite. We have the idea of transposing specific policies that do not have consequence, and alas, 20 years later, they were not the best policies, and we have to go back and to rethink. We were a continent of peace in the 1990s, and now suddenly we have discovered war, and we have to prepare for war within 1 month, 2 months, 3 months. And this is exactly what we don't want. We have to focus on particularities, on the sovereignty of each member state, on our differences, and exactly what makes us together, which is Europeans. We have built a continent over centuries with specific characteristics, and these characteristics should be focused and mentioned in the beginning of the new treaties. Thank you so much.
Kanorski, ladies and gentlemen. Well, I join, of course, to the thanks to our host, our party, for the invitation, but as I am invited here for the third or fourth time, if I take part in these conferences, I feel rather like a host, not a guest. Thank you very much. Well, Adrian, the European Union is a battlefield. In virtually all areas, the member states fight minor and major battles with each other, make alliances, win or lose. This is nothing unusual. In any case, nothing to be upset about. As long as the terms of the game are fair and clear, everything's fine. Unfortunately, this has not been the case for a long time. Since new countries joined the EU, the process of changing the rules is so that it's always the strongest players and the richest economies who have the last word has begun. And countries like Poland or Romania have always been supplicants of Germany or France. The process of changing the treaties is another part of this process. The abolition of veto rights, the taking away of further competences from the member states and handing them over to Brussels, or the obligation to adopt the euro, are all ways of reducting the sovereignty of individual nations. National elections will no longer be of any significance. It will be the Commission or the European Parliament where the liberals and the left hold the majority that will make decisions for us. When this phase of institutional revolution is over, our opposition will no longer matter. We will lose more votes and be forced to accept more ideological revolutions, climate policy, migration, or the future of agriculture are at stake in this game. Perhaps now, in the elections on 9th of June, we will have one last chance to stop the process of changing the treaty. We heard repeatedly when we were in power in Poland that the right of veto was harmful to the European Union, that it delays decision making and that it should be abolished. This is an obvious lie in the interest of major countries such as Germany. The veto right protects the Union from disintegration, forces compromises, and eases disputes. Sovereign and independent states have the right to have different, sometimes conflicting interests. We must understand, respect, and reconcile them with each other. If we do away with the veto, those states that are forced to accept ideas contrary to their interests may end up breaking the European Union, and this is not in the interest of either Poland or Romania. This is not the first time that Germany and France have wanted to cement their power from above by changing the rules. Previously, in 2004, they wanted to push through the so-called Constitution for Europe, which was rejected in referendums by citizens who did not want more centralization and stronger bureaucracy in Brussels. Let us therefore take the opportunity presented by the elections and throw the project to change the treaties in the trash by electing parties that care about the sovereignty of our homelands and nations. Mulțumesc!
It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Claudio, Travis, and the entire Instituto Conservatore, and congratulations. An outstanding conference. Now, last November marked the 30th anniversary of the Maastricht Treaty's entry into effect. That is, the European Union, at least in this latest stage, is 30 years old now, and as many is experiencing now, or having a mid-30s crisis. And rightly so, I would say, because its track record is not very positive overall. After 30 years of existence, the EU has failed to address effectively, in unity and solidarity, that is, as a union, the greatest challenges it has faced from the outset. The cause of the 2008 Great Recession can still be heard, especially in some countries, such as mine, where entire generations have suffered the cost and their life's projects have been taken away. We failed to act again in 2020 when the COVID pandemic struck. We first left Italy alone, and then the response was to take away our God-given rights and confine our population, destroy our economies to fight the virus, and, well, illegally, immorally, in many cases, or in most cases, and illegally in some, as it was the case of my country, Spain, for instance, where the Constitutional Court ruled that the two states of alarm declared by our government were indeed unconstitutional. What a surprise from a coalition government of socialists, communists, with the support of separatists. And most EU countries, with a few brave exceptions, pushed this authoritarian response, which was also fueled and imposed by the EU, a response that prevented people from providing to their families, destroyed businesses that had been operating for decades. In short, the EU failed the test. And it is failing again to address one of the most pressing issues of our time, which is the Ukraine war. It is not looking at the national interests of its member states and making those its own, as it should. But as for domestic EU affairs, EU countries are today more radicalized than they were 30 years ago, despite the emphasis on democratic values. And we have so many more fault lines dividing our societies. Again, much blame is of EU officials legislating while being totally foreign to our everyday needs, issuing regulation that is ideologically charged and in many instances directly opposed to our interests, both national and individual. A few weeks ago, I was attending my 50th or so tour of the EU Parliament, which is my go-to pen for this point. And during the talk we were giving, the EU officials stressed how important, he did so over and over again, how important EU democratic and political participation was in the upcoming elections, and how the EU and democracy were two sides of the same coin. And I was slightly falling asleep, so I decided to spice things up a bit by asking if democracy was the only thing the EU was selling. Because on the one hand, we know that's not the case, as we see too many authoritarian tics or impulses. But even if that was the case, even if the EU was the pinnacle of democracy, I think that wouldn't be enough. I am actually sorry, but it's not enough. Now, Europe must rediscover that it has a soul, and if we don't, everything crumbles. Let's speak of immigration, as we have today, for instance. How can we honestly expect immigrants to integrate into nothingness if we do not present a culture, a civilization that they can integrate into? They would rather keep their own, and why not sell it or impose it to us? Anyway, I said something along these lines to that EU official, and he found himself lost for words, but if Lutz could kill, I would be hit there. In short, the 30 years experiment towards the United States of Europe has failed, and it is our job to call it out, but also to put forward an alternative Europe. And this is something that we conservatives are not very good at. We have an expertise on analysis and diagnosis, but not so much at prescribing treatments. One example is that of regulation. We are allergic to too much regulation, or regulation in general, and the EU is a regulatory superpower. Well, I think it's compatible to call for deregulation, while at the same time making good use of that regulatory superpower and regulate first and regulate well. What we do have, though, is a vision of a Europe of nations that cannot and will not exist if we do not recognize, obviously, that we indeed have different national interests, different cultures, different histories, but that we nevertheless share a worldview onto which we can rebuild the most flourishing civilization the world has ever seen. For let us not be fooled, every civilization has some good and bad things, but that does not make every civilization equal. There are some which are better and some that are worse, and ours is superior to every other competing civilization, and let us therefore defend it. There's a quote by a Spanish thinker, Ramiro de Maeztu, that I think captures this. He was killed by the communists at the beginning of the Spanish Civil War in 1936. And he said, ser es defenderse, which means to be is to defend oneself. And to defend ourselves, our way of life, our principles, our God, our children, is precisely what we must. Those that came before us did so in much more dangerous times, and we have no excuse not to act. Now, before I finish, allow me to point out one last thing that I believe is also important and not heard very often in these type of conferences. It's a warning. In this conservative revival we are part of, the ascent and advance of the new right across the West, there are two temptations I would urge you to avoid, because I find them of great concern. The first thing is that if our ideas are indeed superior, both morally and instrumentally, to every other, we must make a greater effort at advancing the cause before our brands. Let us not forget that we, individuals and political parties alike, are just vessels whose job is to carry a set of beliefs, principles, ideas. Let us therefore strive to push them and not leave off them. That's something leftists do, that's something globalists do. We must be better than that. The second temptation is linked to the previous one. We must lead by example. In every exciting times, as the ones we live today, leaders arise in civil society, media, politics, etc., and also a few prophets, some fake, some genuine. And those leaders and prophets can easily forget that they need to do what they preach and also realize that personal responsibility, as we've heard today, is as important or more than other duties. We must be reminded, myself included, that we are many, that there are many, excuse me, who can lead organizations and some that can lead parties and nations. We are all expendable in most spheres of life, but indispensable in some. Only I can be a good husband to my wife and a good father to my three daughters. Let me assure you, it means nothing to win the world if you lose your own, and that would also be counterproductive to the movement, as we would be all vessels for such precious cargo. You might think that I say this because my youth, lack of experience, of naivety, and that's possible, probably. But it doesn't make what I just said any less true. You might also think that this is not how politics work, certainly, but it is how our politics should work. Let us not forget it. Thank you. Gracias.
Dear friends, do we need treaty changes in the EU? Guy Verhofstadt really believes we do. But if Guy Verhofstadt advocates this, it's actually reason enough not to want this. But okay, let's have a closer look. First, I would like to start with the following question. Why was the EU established? The answer is to have an internal market for economic cooperation between member states, to improve people's lives. But there was also a limitation to this cooperation. Nobody ever mentions this, but Article 5 of the Treaty of the EU is crucial. It lays out subsidiarity as a fundamental principle. The text is as follows. The limits of the Union competences are governed by the principle of conferral. The use of Union competences is governed by the principle of subsidiarity and proportionality. This means we do at national level what we can do at national level. We only do at the EU level what we cannot do at the national level. Unfortunately, that's not how it goes in practice. The bureaucratic centralists are addicted to power. I will explain six ways in which they break Article 5 to gain more and more power. First of all, they use or abuse each and every crisis. Whether there is a financial crisis, a war in Ukraine, or a COVID crisis, the answer is always the same. More power and more money to the EU. They never waste a good crisis. Second, if there's no crisis, they create a crisis to gain power. Just look at the issue of climate change as supposedly an existential threat. The solution to this problem would be a Green Deal to eliminate carbon emissions and to control people's lives. Third, they stretch the meaning of the existing treaties. The treaties denote that the EU cannot have a common debt. But with the COVID recovery funds, the EU created an exception. An exception. Now we are indebted 800 billion euros until 2058. Our children will have to pay for this. If that's not permanent, I don't know what it is. And indeed, this paved the way for more common debt, for so-called war bonds. Those conversations have started. Fourth, the EU centralists, they simulate democratic participation by inviting so-called NGOs, which they themselves have funded. These NGOs always suggest more left liberal policy and more EU integration. They deliver what they are paid for. Fifth, judges in the European Court of Justice. They are bureaucrats who always rule in favor of more EU power. The central problem here is that European Union law supersedes national law. This should be reversed. And the sixth way in which Article 5 is broken is the proposed treaty change. The last veto powers would be abolished. We must not allow that to happen. If this happens, we are heading for a new kind of communism. A communism of technocrats. They want total control over people's lives. And let me conclude by saying this. We do not have the luxury to be divided. We have to do it in the name of our children and grandchildren. The main goal must be to stop this globalist, to stop this wokeist, and to make the nation states our priority. We do so by working together with all the conservatives in the European Parliament
and on the European Council. Let's win the upcoming elections, and let's make Europe great again. Thank you so much.
You said that only warned me to be inside of 7 minutes. That's why I try to compress my intervention. And I welcome all the guests on behalf of my party. And I will be ready to continue in Romania. That's why I have enough time to move to the second voton. Suntem într-o zi aleasă și mă bucură că într-o zi aleasă avem și oameni aleși în față. În România se celebrează Ziua Florilor, Ziua Intrării Domnului Iisus Hristos în Ierusalim și noi avem, prezervăm un supranume în această parte de lume, România fiind considerată grădina Maicii Domnului. Vorbesc atent pentru a se produce o traducere corectă. You know, the first betrayer is your translator. Facem această activitate sub egida Institutului Eminescu, un institut creat în interiorul Partidului pentru Unitatea Românilor. Eminescu nu este doar un titlu, Eminescu este poetul nostru universal, fondator în România a conceptelor fundamentale ale conservatorismului, unul dintre cele mai importante, asupra cărora vom reveni sau vor fi tangibile ideile, este cea a statului organic bazat pe legea naturală. Insist pe această idee pentru că Europei de astăzi, cea pe care vrem să o facem din nou mare, îi lipsește chiar această componentă a respectului față de legea naturală și prea multă inventică a unor obsesii personale. Doamnelor și domnilor, îmi pun întrebarea și ca mine și-au mai pus-o și alții. De ce ne-am adunat noi aici? De ce simțim nevoia să fim împreună cei care recunoaștem și susținem filozofia conservatoare? Foarte simplu. Pentru că simțim un pericol. Un pericol existențial. Pentru că avem aceeași percepție și reacționăm din aceleași motive față de declinul european. În toate domeniile. Am fost foarte atent la toate luările de cuvânt. Toate aceste luări de cuvânt subliniază, relevă o amenințare directă asupra civilizației noastre. Civilizația noastră aflată la ora actuală la limita unei dezintegrări ontologice. Iată de ce acest semnal de alarmă perceput de noi, români, transferat către dumneavoastră în unele dintre cele mai nobile și sincere concepte, au primit răspunsul prin abordarea dumneavoastră inteligentă, de substanță, pentru care personal vă mulțumesc. S-au scos în evidență marile provocări, unele de nivel global, dar cu o accentuare nemai întâlnită în spațiul continentului european. Migrația ilegală, invazia migraționistă, secularizarea, dispariția esenței lui Dumnezeu din sufletul omului european și apariția unui monstru. Acest monstru se numește leadership ilegitim și descalificat. Ne conduc cei care nu merită. Întrebarea, cine îi trage pe dreapta? Națiunile noastre, fiecare în parte, trebuie să ia această hotărâre și să aducă înapoi la cârmâria Europei cei cu credință în Dumnezeu, cu dragoste de oameni, cu iubire de națiuni, care nu sunt fandosiți la niște idei fabricate în laboratoare și eturbete. Iată de ce numitorul comun al acestei întruniri, dragii mei, îl poate numi, fără teama de a greși, că lansăm la București un conservatorism existențial. Nu unul formal, nu unul politic. Unul existențial. Trebuie să ne conservăm, să ne conservăm viața așa cum ne-a dat-o Dumnezeu unul. Suntem aici pentru a transmite această nouă formulă de abordare, pentru că este o formulă a condiției umane. Nu engleză, nu română, nu germană, nu poloneză. A condiției umane a omului european, din perspectiva biologică. Există amenințarea să dispărăm fizic, biologic, pentru că se vrea o metisare accentuată. Asta este Europa îmbreață? Dispariția diferențelor nu se face prin mutilarea limbilor. Este posibil ca mâine sau poimâine să auzim o nouă directivă spunând că de mâine vom vorbi un cyberlang, o limbă cibernetică. Este o chestiune de apărarea profilului identitar natural al fiecărei entități naționale. Iată de ce exact ceea ce v-am spus considerăm că printr-o manipulare perfidă, aparent foarte ușor de ingurgitat, așa am semnat tratatul, o să ajungem și la tratat. Acțiunile sunt cât se poate de țintite pentru o dezidentizare a fiecărei entități în parte. Că cel mai ușor este conduși cu o tabula rasă. O masă fără identitate, fără personalitate, fără voce. We said, may the voices be European and listen. Hai să facem ca vocile noastre să fie auzite într-o consonanță armonică a fiecare națiune în parte. Al minter, suntem suicidari editari a propriei noastre existențe. Răspunsul care îl dăm, am să fac o parafrază a lui Eminescu, care avea să spună, suntem români buni. În latină, nos homo europeus sumum et punctum. Noi suntem europeni și punct. Vorbim despre Marea Europa, sau Europa Mare, sau Măreția Europei, Europa Măreață. Europa a fost mare. Adică se poate face confuzia între Europa Puterii. Să nu uităm că am avut o Europa rea. O Europa care a produs inchiziție, cruciale, colonialism. Două războaie mondiale, holocaust, ură. Și aia era o Europa puternică. Noi strigăm de aici, din inima românității. Nu la acea Europa ne referim noi astăzi. Nu acea Europa am vorbit-o împreună. Noi trebuie să vorbim actualmente de Europa miracolului, Europa libertății, a frumuseții, a credinței, Europa lui Voltaire, a lui Schumann, a lui Dante, a lui Erasmus, Europa al Aristotel, Europa zilelor noastre, Europa armoniei. Pentru că de vom voi a face din nou aceeași Europa again, din nou, nu este bine. Nu există măreție în sine. Măreția Europei o fac națiunile care o compun. Națiunile sale unite. Asta trebuie să fim. Națiunile unite ale Europei, care să avem aceeași partitură existențială. Nu poți avea o Europă măreață și cu măreție, având în interior națiuni minore și tăcute. Iată de ce tratatul despre care vorbim în această temă este unul ușor de înțeles, dar foarte greu de aplicat, pentru că nu răspunde legilor naturale de funcționare a națiunilor. Este un instrument de impunere a unor voințe, din bune intenții, dar care practic aplicate au degenerat, au defectat de la cursul lor. Am studiat toate tratatele de la 1806, la Tilsit, între Napoleon și Alexandru I al Rusiei, până la ultimul, al 100-ului, al Tratatului de Funcționare a Uniunii Europene, a Tratatului Forțelor Convenționale pentru Armamente, Tratatul de la Trianon, care nu este, la ora actuală, contestat, Tratatul de la Paris, în 1947, toate au defectat și au dispărut pentru că se vrea o destabilizare și să se lucreze în ce? Într-o continuă coliziune și conflict între părți. Iată de ce Europa, dragii mei, are nevoie de un singur tratat la ora actuală. Un tratat al păcii continue. Nu a susținerii unui război care este crimă continuă. Dacă noi vom reuși ca aceste tratate să le îndreptăm prin voința națiunilor noastre și să fie un numitor comun al voinților armonizate și nu o dictare după voce și ureche dintr-un centru anume, așa zis, imperial, atunci, cu adevărat, ne vom regăsi calea. Dragii mei, eu vă mulțumesc că ați avut atâta răbdare să ne ascultați, atâta voință să ne însoțiți și am să închei cu o sublimă replică a Apostolului Petru. Sic Deus pronomis, quis contra nos est. Dacă Dumnezeu este cu noi, cine ne poate sta împotrivă? Vă mulțumesc!